Hi, I'm Carly McAvoy. I'm talking about rules for exponents today, which is part of homework 5-6A in Math 97. So taking a look at my work over here, there's several rules for exponents. I'll show you the rules and then we'll look at examples of using them. The first rule is if you have a same base, which in this case x, to the two different powers, you just add those powers together. So x to the a times x to the b is x to the a plus b, and I'll show you how that works. And then the second rule is if you have x to a power and you raise that to entire quantity to a power, then you multiply the powers x to the a times b. If you have two factors, x and y, and you raise that to a power, both factors go to that power, so x goes to that power and y goes to that power. So we're kind of using rule number two, but we're just saying how it's going to both factors inside the parentheses, or all if you had multiple factors. If you have a quotient and you're raising something to the power, both the numerator and the denominator go to a power, that power. And then two things that may go without saying for you, but I wanted to mention, and that is if you have something to the first power, we don't need to write an exponent at all. It's just like assuming that it's there. And if you have something to the zero power, that equals one. And for some people, that's something that's confusing. If you think about 3 to the third power is 27. 3 to the second power is 27 divided by 3, or 9. 3 to the first power is 9 divided by 3, or 3. 3 to the zero power, well, that's 3 divided by 3, which is 1. You see how it has to be 1 to fit into that pattern. 1 times 3 is 3, 3 times 3 is 9, times 27. And that would work for any power. If I do 2 to the third power is 8, divide 8 by 2 and you get 4. Divide 4 by 2 and you get 1. I mean 2, and divide 2 by 2 and you get 1. So if you look at it, anything to the zero power has to be 1. It always fits into the pattern as you look at that. Okay, so let's look at some examples. I have the first one is going to use that first rule. That is, I have the same base and I have different powers. So what this really looks like is y times y and times y times y times y. If I expanded that, you can see that I have 5 y's. But the shortcut says instead of having to expand it out and actually count them, I can just add the two powers. So I can add 2 and 3 and get y to the fifth power. The base stays the same and you add the powers. If you have something like number 2, I'm going to do the same thing, except I have these coefficients, 2 and 3. Coefficient is just the number multiplying the variable, remember. So I can think about doing 2 times 3, or in other words, working with the numbers and the coefficients, and then I'm going to deal with the x factors that I have. 2 times 3 is 6, and then again, I could write this out and see that I have 4 x's and 5 more x's. But I don't need to do that because I have that first rule that I have up here, and that is x to the ninth power, 4 plus 5. And again, we can do this here. I wanted to show you from this rule number 5 where you have something to the first power. When I see that p, I'm going to multiply my coefficients together. These parentheses are just another way to say multiply. And then I have a p, and that's really p to the first, and then I have a p to the fifth. So I multiply the numbers 3 times 3, and I add the powers 1 plus 5, and that's going to be my answer to that. So that's really using the first rule and the fifth rule that I have up there, and I just numbered them randomly. I don't have that sequence. It doesn't have to be that way, it's just how I numbered them. So in number 4, I'm going to use the second rule. That is, if I have a power to a power, I multiply. So I have 7 to the second power. So what that really looks like is b to the seventh twice, right? And if you think about our first rule, if I have the same base, I just add the powers. So by saying I have 7 to the second power, I mean I have two sets of 7. And if I use that rule, 7 plus 7, I get 14. If I use the second rule, I say 7 times 2, which is 14. So you can see that it all comes back to being true. I can add those two powers together if I write it side by side like this. Or instead of having to even do that, I can just multiply those powers. If I have a power to a power, I multiply. Now, number 5 is using the second and the third rules because I do have power to a power, but I have more than one factor inside this parentheses. And so what this really says is 2x to the third 4 times. And so why I wrote that out was because I wanted you to see that that 2 is repeating 4 times just like the x. So it's a really common mistake for people to say 2x to the 12th because they multiply the 3 times 4, but they don't do anything with that 2. If this whole thing is being repeated 4 times, I actually have 2 to the 4th power and I have x to the 3rd to the 4th power. And that's what this rule is saying. Each factor inside there is being raised to the power that's on the outside. And so you can, for me, I would say 2 to the 4th is a very acceptable way to write the answer. I think on the Pearson products, usually they like to have that expanded out. 2 to the 4th power, you can certainly use your calculator and get 16, or maybe you know that in your head. And the second part is 3 to the 4th power. I can use this rule right here that says if I have a power raised to a power, I just multiply, so I get x to the 12th. All right, and this is similar. I have to do a few things, though. I want to get rid of the parentheses here because this 2 to the 4th, this 4th power has nothing to do with the 2c. So I'm going to simplify this part first, and I have c to the 2 to the 4th. So those are power raised to a power. That's that second rule. 2 times 4 is 8. And now I'm back to something that kind of looks like number 3. And so I'm thinking about I have a 2, and I have a c, and I have a c to the 8th. What power is c? C is actually first power. Even though I don't see it, I have to assume that it's there. And so I have 2, and then I keep my base the same, and I add my powers. That gives me 9. Something I want to just, I think maybe I didn't, it'll come to me. Okay, wasn't sure I gave you an example, but I want to make sure you have, but I think I did. Okay, the next part, I'm taking negative 2 m squared into the 5th to the 4th power. And so that looks like this, only instead of having 2 factors, I've got 3 factors in there. Notice that the negative 2 is in parentheses, so the entire negative 2 goes to the 4th power. And then I have m squared, and that goes to the 4th power. And then I have n to the 5th, and that goes to the 4th power. So every factor in the parentheses goes to that power. Negative 2 to the 4th power, you can do that on your calculator. Make sure that when you put that into your calculator, if you do, you don't do this, negative 2 to the 4th power, because that's something different, right? Because we didn't put it in parentheses. That's not what our problem says. Our problem says negative 2 in parentheses to the 4th power. And that's 2 different answers. So you can see how those 2 things are different. If I don't have parentheses around it, it becomes negative. And if I have parentheses around it, it's positive. So make sure if you're going to use your calculator that you enter it correctly. So that's 16. And then m to the 2 to the 4, that's a power raised to a power. So that is m to the 8th. And n to the 5 times 4 is n to the 20th. That's as far as I can go. I can't combine the m's and n's because they have different bases. Okay, so here's what I was going to say. I don't really see anything exactly like what I want. Sometimes people have like 2 to the 5th times 2 to the 3rd, and they want to say 4 to the 8th power. But the rule is you keep the base the same. Even if it's a number, you have to stick with that because what we really have is 5 twos, and then 3 more twos. I don't see any fours in there, right? So I really have 2 to the 8th power. I don't have 4 to the 8th power because I just have a bunch of twos. So don't multiply the base. The base stays the same, and you add the exponents there. Okay, number 8, I'm using the fourth rule, but also kind of combined with the power rule up here, because I have power, I have things inside raised to a power. But what the fourth rule says is that if I have a quotient like this, everything on the top and the bottom goes to that power. So I have 2 to the third power, x to the third power, and on the bottom I have y squared to the third power. So everything in the top and the bottom of that fraction is going to a power. 2 to the third power is 8. X to the third power, I don't need to do anything with that. And down below I have y 2 to the third, and that is this rule where I have a power raised to a power, I'm going to multiply, so I get y to the sixth. Similar type of thing on number 9, you might want to stop the video and try that and see if you can do it on your own. What I have is negative 3 to the fourth power, a to the third to the fourth power. On the bottom, 5 to the fourth power, and b squared to the fourth power. Notice I put parentheses around the negative 3, but I didn't put it around the 5. Well, I want to make sure I note that the negative was inside the parentheses. Here there's no negative, so I don't have to worry about it. So negative 3 to the fourth power is actually saying negative 3 4 times, right? And so that's positive because it's negative times negative. These two cancel each other out, and then these two cancel each other out. So I get 81. That's positive 81. And I have a to the 12th, 3 times 4. 5 to the 4th power is 625. You can try that on your calculator to make sure. And then b to the 8th power. And that's what would be finished because I don't have any other common bases or anything that I can cancel. And the last couple of problems I wanted to show you have the zero rule, number 6, in it. If something is to the zero power, it equals 1. We looked at that up here, why that is. And so this parentheses, the whole thing is to the zero power. So that means that whole thing equals 1, so that's just going to be 4. Now, here I'm saying negative x to the zero power. What is that? Well, it's really this part is the part that's to the zero power, not the negative out front, just like the 4 wasn't to the zero power here. So that equals negative 1. If I had negative x in parentheses to the zero power, that would be positive 1. Okay, so that should get you through the first half of that homework, and I will continue with the rest of this in a few minutes. Have a great day.